My name is Kristen, and this channel is Keeping It Lit, where I like to talk about all things literary. And today I am going to talk about Sherlock Holmes, A Study in Scarlet. So this story was the very first Sherlock Holmes story written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. And it is the story where we very first get introduced to Dr. John Watson, and where he in turn gets introduced to Sherlock Holmes. So the story starts, it's told from Watson's perspective. It's actually a first person account, so it's like it's written by Dr. John Watson. And he tells the story of how he has just gotten back from being a soldier in Afghanistan, and he is recuperating after a leg injury in London. And the cost of living in London is kind of high, so he is in need of a roommate. And he meets an old friend in London and lets his old friend know this, that he's kind of looking out for someone to share rooms with, to kind of split the cost of living with. And his friend lets him know that he has actually just had a similar conversation with someone that very morning who said the same thing. And this person is Sherlock Holmes. And Watson wants to immediately meet him and says it sounds like a great arrangement for them to share rooms together. And his friend is kind of like, well, you may think that, but before you make up your mind, maybe you should meet him first. And Watson's like, is he disagreeable? Is there something wrong with him? And the friend is kind of like, well, no, but you just kind of have to meet him. So he introduces John Watson to Sherlock Holmes, and upon their first meeting, Sherlock Holmes automatically assumes that Watson has been in Afghanistan, and Watson doesn't realize, like, how did you know that? We haven't met before. And that's when Holmes kind of talks about the deduction skills that he's so well known for, he becomes so well known for later on, that he sees that he has a tan, but that it's not his natural skin tone, and that he sees he has a leg injury. And so these two things combined has led him to conclude that he must be a soldier from Afghanistan. So they talk a little bit, and they agree that they are going to share rooms at 221B Baker Street, the famous address. And they move in together. And at first, Watson doesn't really know what Sherlock Holmes does for a living, because they don't talk about it really at first. And he just knows that he's kind of a scholarly type person, that he seems to study like chemicals and have an interest in that, but that he's not like a professor. So Watson doesn't really know what he is or what he does, but he knows he must work. He has an income, and he does meet with people. He has people come to the flat, who are apparently his clients, but Watson can't really figure out what it is that he does for a living. So they finally talk about it one morning, and Sherlock Holmes lets him know that he is a consulting detective, that he works with Scotland Yard, and he works with private individuals. When they can't figure out a case, they come and they consult with him, and he uses his powers of deduction to help them figure out the cases. And he kind of explains it as he works backwards from the problem, or he works backwards from the incident that happened. Like, most people can see events happening and see how those events will lead up to an incident, but his profession is to see the actual incident and try to figure out the chain of events that led up to that incident. So he kind of works in a backwards way than what other people do and what the normal mind thinks of. So, in a study in Scarlet, this particular case, he is asked by Gregson. This is when we're first introduced to the character of Gregson, who works for Scotland Yard, to come and look into a case, to consult with them on a case. And he invites Watson to come along with it, to come along with him on this, just because Watson hasn't seen him at work, really. And Watson's kind of still skeptical about this whole consulting detective thing. He's like, how can you, even though he's seen a little bit firsthand of Sherlock Holmes' talents, he's still very skeptical of it. So Sherlock Holmes invites him to come along with him, and he does. So they go, and it's essentially where Gregson is and Lestrade, this is the first time we meet Lestrade, who also works for Scotland Yard. They're the two main detectives. They meet them at this house where they have found this dead body of a man who has no marks on him, and he has identification identifying him as Drebber, Enoch Drebber. Also, a card or something showing his connection to a man named Stinkerson or Stinkerton. I don't remember which one it was. I'll have to look that up, and I'll try to put it somewhere so that you know what it was. I think it was Stinkerton, maybe. But as like his, who is like his secretary. And they also find a ring in the room. It's not on his person, but they find it in the room, I believe. And there's also written in the corner in blood the word rock, R-R-A-C-H, which Lestrade immediately thinks that they're going to write the word Rachel. But Holmes lets him know that, no, Roch is actually a German word that means revenge. So the murderer wrote that on there. Wrote the word revenge, and Holmes immediately thinks that it's just put there to throw them off the trail of who the actual murderer is. So these are the clues that they have to start with, and Sherlock Holmes immediately makes several deductions from it. With the ring, he and Watson leave, and he gets a replica ring and puts out an advertisement saying that he's found this ring, and for whoever owns it to come claim it. And this person does come claim it, an old woman, or an apparent old woman, who says it belonged to her daughter and that that's her ring. And she leaves, and Sherlock Holmes follows her, and they think that this must be either the killer or someone associated with the killer. But she actually ends up giving him the slip. Then later, we have Gregson, who comes back and makes a report to Sherlock Holmes, saying that he has spoken with the person who was boarding Drebber, and who is a woman, and finds out that Drebber was very not gentlemanly towards her daughter, was making advances towards that woman's daughter, and so she threw him out, and her son was actually very angry with him, and so Gregson thinks it was her son, who was the daughter's brother, who has probably killed, was the one who killed Drebber, possibly. But during this time, then Lestrade comes to make his report, and he lets them know that he has found Stinkerson, I don't remember his name exactly, but he has found that gentleman whose name was referenced on the dead body of Drebber. He finds him, and finds out that he finds him dead, actually, and he has been stabbed, apparently, and he has a case with him containing two pills, and Sherlock Holmes I don't remember if I said this before, but he had already come to the conclusion that Drebber must have died from poison because he had no marks on his body and nothing apparently to have given him a heart attack or anything. So Holmes comes to the conclusion that he was poisoned. So these two pills that were found on Stankerton, Sherlock Holmes looks at them, and now this part is kind of sad, really. I was like, oh, I don't remember that happening, because I had read this this story previously, and I didn't remember this part, but they have an old dog brought up, and they feed it the first pill. Sherlock Holmes feeds it the first pill, and the first pill does nothing. And the dog is old, and it was going to pass away anyways. So I just want to put that out there. Sherlock Holmes isn't a complete monster. So he gives the dog the first pill. It doesn't do anything. Then he gives the dog the second pill, and it kills it. So they realize that the two pills that were found on Stankerton, one was actual poison, and one was not poison. So Holmes, during this time, he has called a cab, as this is going on, and as Lestrade is there making his report and they're testing the poisons on the dog. So Holmes, has the cabbie that drove the cab sent for to be brought up to his room, and the cabbie comes, and when he comes, Holmes arrests him, puts handcuffs on him, and he tries to get away, and they end up wrestling him back into the room. But at this point, they all realize that Holmes has figured it out, that it was the cabbie this whole time that has been a part of this murder. And then that concludes the part one of this story. So I will go on to part two in just a moment. Okay, so it is now a different time of day, so sorry if the lighting is different, but so the second part of A Study in Scarlet, it is, I want to say first, it's had a little bit of attention in the past because it sheds a very negative light on the Mormon faith, and I do not know a great deal about the Mormon faith, and I'm by no means an expert on it, but I do know that at the time that A Study in Scarlet was written, it was the Victorian era, and while Sir Arthur Conan Doyle said at the time that everything he wrote was based on facts, he did sensationalize those facts, and he did write them in a way to dramatize them for the story so that there would be more dramatic effect in the story. So while some of the things happened, maybe he wrote them for dramatic effect, and later on in his life, there are rumors or stories about him privately apologizing to people in the Mormon faith because of that, how negative they are portrayed in this story. But just wanted to put that out there. I don't have a stance on it, but I just wanted to before I go into to telling you about the next portion, just wanted to put that out there. So the next portion of the story, we are hearing this captives who Sherlock Holmes and Lestrade and Gregson and Watson, this gentleman that they have arrested now, who was the cabbie, he is relating this story, the things that happened, what happened in the past. So we go back, and there is this man named John Ferrier, I think is what his name was, and he is with a little girl, and they are the last two survivors of a band of pioneers who were traveling together, and I believe it is in Utah, that they're traveling. It's a desert area that they're traveling in. And they're on the brink of death themselves. Everyone else has died. The little girl, her mother has died. She's not related to John in any real way, but since they're the last two survivors, he's trying to take care of her. And they don't have much water left. They don't have food. They don't have shelter. They're expecting to die out in the desert. And then this group of Latter-day Saints, Mormons, find them, led by their leader is Brigham Young, I believe is how you say his name. They find them and they let them know that they will allow them to stay with them, and they will give them food and shelter and water and everything if they will promise to convert to the Mormon faith and follow all of their rules. So John agrees to this. He basically adopts the little girl Lucy and thinks of her as his daughter. And they live with the Mormons, and he ends up becoming wealthy, becoming like a farmer, and developing his wealth. And Lucy grows up and becomes a very beautiful and charismatic young lady. And she catches the eye of a gentleman named Jefferson Hope. And Jefferson Hope is not a Mormon. And John, Lucy's adopted dad, has decided that he does not want her to marry a Mormon anyways. He is not into the whole Mormon faith. He's not into their ways and the things that they do. So he does not want her to marry one of them. So whenever she starts seeing Jefferson Hope, and Jefferson Hope asks for her hand in marriage, he gives it because Jefferson Hope, he thinks, is going to be a good husband for her. And they're very much in love, and they're planning on getting married. But then John is visited by the leader of the Mormons, who lets him know that Lucy needs to marry one of their men, one of the Mormon men. And he gives John two choices of men that that Lucy can choose to marry. And they're both the sons of leaders. And one of them is Enoch Drebber, who you will remember from earlier. And the other is Stinkerson, whose name, hopefully I will have found it and put it in here somewhere so we know what the actual name was. But she can choose to marry between those two, is what the leader tells John. John's not having it, so he sets up for Jefferson to come help sneak him and Lucy away. They're going to run away together. But it's not so easy because John is being watched. Both John and Lucy are being watched by the Mormon people, and they know that there are sects of the Mormon people. There are groups that they think are violent. They've seen people mysteriously go missing when they've disagreed with the rules. So the leader tells John that he has 30 days, that Lucy has 30 days to make her choice. And as the days go by, that they're leaving marks on John's house in different places, and he never sees them come and never hears them or anything, but they always leave something like a number to count down the days. They leave a 29, and then a 28, and then a 27, and then a 26, so they're counting down the days. But finally, on the last day, Jefferson comes back. He makes it back. he gets John and Lucy, and he's sneaking them away, and they make it out of the Mormon camp, and they make it away from everybody. But then John goes out, or not John, Jefferson goes out hunting to find them some food. And while he's out hunting, he comes back, and John has been killed, and Lucy has been taken away. And he finds out that she has been taken away. She has been forced to marry Drebber. And that she has, out of just sadness and heartbrokenness, died. So he goes and he finds her. She's actually laid out to be buried. And so he goes to her body and he takes the wedding ring off of her finger and just gives her one last kiss and that type of thing. And then he vows that he will avenge her. So that is the backstory. And that is how, that is who the murderer is, Jefferson Hope. He has tracked Drebber and Stankerton all the way from Utah all the way to London, and he has taken the two pills, and what he did was make Drebber take one, and he said he would take the other, and let God judge who was guilty between them. He mixed them up where he didn't know which one was going to be the poisoned one. And of course, Drebber took the poisoned one, and that killed him. And Hope is actually dying of an aneurysm at this point anyways, and so he has a nosebleed after the excitement of killing Drebber. And so he writes with the blood is just blood from his nose, where he writes the word R-I-C-H, which means revenge in German. And then after Drebber is killed, Stankerton stays in his hotel and won't come out, refuses to come out. And so Hope has to go in through the window to try to get him. And when he goes in through the window, he has the pills that he's going to offer him to take. But then they end up getting into a scuffle, and he ends up stabbing Stankerton to kill him. But that's why the pills are on Stankerton, and that's why Sherlock Holmes was able to find them and deduce that that was the poison that was used to kill Drebber. Hope explains to them at this point that he tells them this story, and he had become a cabbie when he came to London, a cab driver, just for the purpose of, because he realized that cab drivers had access to everybody, and then that's what gave him access to Drebber and to Stankerton. So he is arrested by Lestrade and Gregson, but he actually dies before his trial because of the aneurysm that he had. So he dies before that. Sherlock Holmes and Watson get the paper, and the next day, and all the credit has been given to Gregson and Lestrade. And so Watson's kind of outraged by this, and he tells Sherlock Holmes that the world needs to know the full story, so that's why he's going to start writing it down and keeping a record of Sherlock Holmes's greatness. So that's how Sherlock Holmes, how it all starts, and just a great, great story. It's when we get introduced to all of the characters who play such a key role in the stories later on, except for Moriarty isn't in this one. He doesn't come till later, but this is the introduction to a bunch of those characters, so very fun. Love Sherlock Holmes, I hope this video was helpful for you. If you are writing a paper or having a discussion on a study in Scarlet, I hope this helps you a little bit. But that's it for now. This has been my review on A Study in Scarlet by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. And until next time, think happy thoughts and read lots of books. Thanks. Bye, guys.